city is a group of plant and animal species that inhabit a given area. Now, inside a community, series of interactions take place, whether it may be interactions between species or the interaction of species with that of the environment. These interactions affect or influence the structure of the community. The biological structure of the community is defined by its species composition and the relative abundance of the species. For a species to be considered a component of a community, first and foremost, the species must be able to survive. They must be able to tolerate the environmental conditions present in the area in which it resides. With this, species tend to differ in environmental tolerances and performances along environmental gradients. One example of this would be the adaptations of poikilotherms, which regulate their body temperature through ectothermy. Each species then has their set of adaptations, which will then help in determining the fundamental niche of a species. As environmental conditions change from location to location, the possible distribution and abundance of that of the species may be affected, which results in the changes in the community structure. It is also good to note the null model, wherein it assumes that the presence and absence of the individual species found in the community are solely a result of the independent responses of each individual species to the prevailing abiotic environment. Therefore, interactions among species have no significant effect or influence on the community structure. However, series of studies indicates that species interactions rather influence both presence and abundance of species within the community. After looking into the biological structure of a community and how the fundamental niche constrains the structure of the community, we now dwell on zonation. Zonation is a result of differences in species tolerance and interactions along environment gradients. Interactions among species modify the fundamental niche. For example, competitors and predators can restrict a species from a community, whereas mutualists can facilitate in a species' presence and abundance within the community. Variations in the abiotic environment can also alter the constraints on species distributions and abundance. Differences in environmental tolerances can also result in the shift in the species present and their relative abundance. These spatial changes in the community structure are referred to as zonation, and this is due to environmental stress, such as desiccation and competitive ability. Species gains a competitive advantage when they acquire most of the resources and have the highest growth rate. Patterns of zonation reflect an interaction between the relative competitive abilities of species in terms of acquiring nutrients and the ability of species to tolerate increasing physical stress. Species interactions are often diffuse and involve several species. Diffuse competition, coined by the late ecologist Robert MacArthur, describes the total competitive effects of a few interspecific competitors. Relative abundance of a species in the community is a function of competitive interactions with a single competitor. However, the relative abundance of the focal species is impacted by competition within a variety of other species in the community. Norma Fowler examined competitive interactions within an old field community by selectively removing species of plants from experimental plots and assessing the growth responses of remaining species. Results showed competitive interactions within the community tended to be rather weak and diffuse, because removing a single species had relatively little effect. Removing groups of species, however, tended to be much stronger, suggesting that individual species compete with several other species for essential resources within the community. Food webs are an excellent means of illustrating the diffuse nature of species interactions, although only a limited view of species interactions is present. Food webs can also illustrate indirect effects. Indirect interactions occur when one species does not interact with a second species directly, but instead influences a third species that does directly interact with the second. For example, although some birds do not interact with vegetation, by preying on certain caterpillars, it allows for the proliferation of the plant the caterpillar mainly consumes. By affecting the outcome of competitive interactions among prey species, predation provides another example of indirect effects within the food webs, and Robert Payne was one of the first ecologists to demonstrate this point. Keystone predation happens when a predator enhances one or more less competitive species by reducing the abundance of the more competitive species. Apparent competition, described by an ecologist named Robert Holt, occurs when two species that do not compete for limited resources affect each other indirectly by being prey for the same predator, and an example of which would be the interaction of krill and copepods as prey for the capelin. Some indirect interactions have negative consequences for the affected species, as in the case of apparent competition, while there are also positive effects in other indirect interactions. Indirect commensalism happens when one species benefits from the relationship while the other is not affected. When the interaction is beneficial to both species, the interaction is termed indirect mutualism. Indirect interactions can be an integrating force in structuring natural communities and has direct implications for conservation and management of natural communities. The hypothesis that all species interactions are important in maintaining community structure suggests that the community is like a house of cards, that is, removing any one species may have a cascading effect on all others. The structure of food chains suggests that the productivity and abundance of populations at any given trophic level are controlled or limited by the productivity and abundance of populations in the level below them, a phenomenon called bottom-up control. When predator populations control the abundance of prey species, a top-down control occurs. Mary Power and her colleagues suggested that the role of top predators, or the carnivores, on community structure can extend to lower trophic levels, influencing the primary producers, or the autotrophs. This type of top-down control is called a trophic cascade, and it occurs when a predator in a food web suppresses the abundance of their prey or the intermediate species, which then increases the abundance of the next lower trophic level or the basal species on which intermediate species feeds on. When the diversity of the environmental factors are relatively homogeneous, community diversity tends to be lower. Since the variety of options for living conditions, food sources, and other factors are quite limited, only the species that is most suited for the said conditions can live in a community, therefore making it less diverse. When the variety increases, however, the conditions can now cater to a wider array of species, therefore making the community more diverse. In general, increased availability of nutrients can support higher rates of photosynthesis, plant growth, and density of plants per unit area. However, a variety of studies have shown an inverse relationship between nutrient availability and plant diversity in communities. Tropical forest communities on soils with lower nutrient availability supported greater number of tree species than did communities on more fertile soils. Michael Huston, an ecologist in Texas State University, hypothesized that the inverse relationship results from reduced competitive displacement under low nutrient availability. Low nutrient availability reduces growth rates and supports a lower density and biomass of vegetation. Species that might dominate under higher nutrient availability cannot realize their potential growth rates and biomass, and thus are unable to displace slower growing, less competitive species. When individuals compete in proportion to their size, symmetric competition occurs. This results to larger plants causing a large decrease in the growth of smaller plants, and small plants cause a small decrease in the growth of larger plants,
proving that competition for below-ground resources is size symmetric because nutrient uptake is proportional to the size of the plant's root system. On the other hand, competition for light or above ground is one-sided or size asymmetric, wherein large plants have disproportionate advantage in competition for light by shading smaller ones. Any factor that reduces the growth rate of a plant initiates a positive feedback loop that decreases the plant's likelihood of obtaining a dominant position in the developing hierarchy. Under low nutrient availability, plant growth rate, size, and density are low for all species. Competition primarily occurs below ground and therefore is symmetric, wherein competitive displacement is low and diversity is maintained. As nutrient availability increases, growth rate, size, and density increase as well. Species that maintain higher rates of photosynthesis and growth exhibit a disproportionate increase in size. Species that achieve high rates of growth and stature under conditions of high soil fertility eventually outcompete and displace the slower growing, smaller stature species, thus reducing the species richness of the community. Unlike the pattern of decreasing species diversity observed in terrestrial plant communities, fertilization results in an increase in the species richness of autotrophs in both freshwater and marine communities. Several factors may affect this, including differences in the role of competition in terrestrial and marine environments. Reduced competition may result from rapid changes in nutrient levels that occur in the water column and restrict competitive dominance for any given species, or different species in the assemblage of phytoplankton may be limited by more than one nutrient, so that no single species has a competitive advantage. With the knowledge of the different factors influencing community structure, people can now understand how everything is connected one way or another. A thorough analysis of the interconnections of species and environmental conditions can aid in conservation efforts and a general understanding of how the environment works. Ecologists and even regular people alike can take from this lesson how micro efforts make a macro effect.